Good morning. On behalf of the congregation of St. Paul's United Church of Christ here in Mechanicsburg, we welcome you. We are grateful you are able to be a part of our Facebook Live worship service. Or if you're tuning in later in the day or in the evening, we're grateful for whenever it is that you're able to participate with us. Just a couple of quick announcements that we have. We will be engaging in a work day in our garden shortly. There are details that have been mailed out in our all church emails. If you're not receiving those or you would like to and you have an email address, let us know that. If not, you can give us a call and we can fill you in. Also, something important to remember, SPOM will be having its Easter egg sale. I guess we have to come up with another name for that, but they are the same delicious Easter eggs that we usually are able to purchase right at Easter time. We will be doing that shortly on a Saturday. You'll be able to come pick those up. We will be observing social distancing. For the details about how all that will work, again, check your all church email or give a call into the office. We are grateful for all the folks who have been staying up with their pledges, who have been able to stay up with their pledges, sending in donations. We very much appreciate that. If you can continue to do that, we will continue to be grateful. And we're also, if this allows our congregation to continue to do the work that we've committed to doing. Now I'd ask that we might join together in our call to worship. It is a poem, a prayer, entitled Locked In by Father Richard Hendrick. Yes, there is fear. Yes, there is isolation. Yes, there is panic buying. Yes, there is sickness. Yes, there is even death. But they say that in Wuhan, after so many years of noise, you can hear the birds again. They say that after just a few weeks of quiet, the sky is no longer thick with fumes, but blue and gray and clear. They say that in the streets of Assisi, people are singing to each other across the empty squares, keeping their windows open so that those who are alone may hear the sounds of family around them. They say that a hotel in the west of Ireland is offering free meals and delivery to the housebound. Today, a young woman I know is busy spreading flyers with her number through the neighborhood, so that the elders may have someone to call on. Today, churches, synagogues, mosques, and temples are preparing to welcome and shelter the homeless, the sick, the weary. All over the world, people are slowing down and reflecting. All over the world, people are looking at their neighbors in a new way. All over the world, people are waking up to a new reality, to how big we really are, to how little control we really have, to what really matters, to love. So we pray and we remember that, yes, there is fear, but there does not have to be hate. Yes, there is isolation, but there does not have to be loneliness. Yes, there is panic buying, but there does not have to be meanness. Yes, there is sickness, but there does not have to be disease of the soul. Yes, there is even death, but there can always be a rebirth of love. Wake to the choices you make as to how to live now, to today, breathe. Listen behind the factory noises of your panic. The birds are singing again. The sky is clearing. Spring is coming. And we are always encompassed by love. Open the windows of your soul. And though you may not be able to touch across the empty square, sing. God forgives us and continues to reach out to us wherever we find ourselves at all times. Let us open ourselves to God's ongoing presence and not limit where and when we turn to God. Amen. Now, as a sign of our reconciliation with God and with one another, wherever you are, turn to the neighbors next to you and neighbors all around the world and pass the peace of Christ. Peace be with you. Peace.
offer a word for the young and the young at heart. This morning, the word for the young focuses on Psalm 23. And I'd like to share a brief story about that that had a really big impact on me. When I was starting my work at the hospital as a chaplain intern, there was a minister that I'd known from before who offered a story that really stuck with me. Her name is Pastor Jan, and she said that I could share this with you today. And the story she told me was this. She said that she was visiting a woman who was very, very sick and who was dying. And she went to visit this woman as she was dying, and this woman had three adult sons, and they were all there in the room, and they were all together in the room, and Pastor Jan read the 23rd Psalm and anointed her with oil and said a prayer, and this woman died. And right after that happened, one of the sons turned to Pastor Jan, and he had tears in his eyes, but he was also smiling, and he said, "That poem," meaning the 23rd Psalm, how did you know about that?" He said, "My mother used to read that to us every night when we were little, before we went to bed. How did you know about that poem?" I think that that's a beautiful, beautiful story, because for me, it helps me to remember that, yes, the Bible is filled with lessons that we can derive from it. We can pull out lessons how we should be living, how we should be acting. But also, the Bible is also just a really, really wonderful book for comfort. Not all parts of the Bible, but some parts of the Bible, we say them because the words connect to us in a really, really deep way. I don't think it's an accident that so many people find comfort from the 23rd Psalm, in part because that's what psalms are. They're songs. And I don't know about you, but for me, music has a way of really connecting with the deepest parts of our soul. Music and poetry that other types of writing just doesn't seem to do. So I don't think it's a surprise that for that person in that moment when he was going through that sadness of his mother dying, he was also connecting to these beautiful words, even if he didn't even know that they came from the Bible. Just think that's really amazing. And it's a really wonderful, wonderful example of how the words from the Bible connect us to something deeper in ourselves, but also in other people all around the world and all throughout history. I mean, people have been saying and praying and singing the words of the 23rd Psalm for thousands of years. That's incredible. Think of all of the comfort that those words have given over all of that time. So that's what I wanted to share this morning. I hope that you find as much peace in that story as I do. Let us pray. Holy God, please help us to remember that the words that we find in your Bible can provide us with so much comfort and so much peace and healing, and can help to connect us to other people. And isn't that a marvelous thing? Amen. Please now, let us listen for the word of God as it is found in the Gospel according to John, chapter 10, verses 7 through 10. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes in only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that and have it abundantly. Here ends the reading from the book of John. Let us listen for the word of God as it is found in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Here ends the reading from the book of Psalms. May God bless our hearing and living of these words. Amen.
Good morning. We have been so blessed that Father Michael Jonkis, the man who wrote On Eagle's Wings, has given to us a new psalm that he wrote in the last few weeks. And it's based on Psalm 23, and we are going to sing it together today. You are going to sing what we call a refrain part, and it happens after each of the three verses. So I'll sing the verses, and you sing the refrain part, which is found in the bulletin that was sent to you in very big print, and it's a wonderful thing. So would you sing with me the O Shelter Me part that's printed in your bulletin, and then we'll go back and we'll do the whole thing together as our middle hymn today. Thank you. So sing along with me. O Shelter Me.
Oh,
is still speaking.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today we're going to celebrate Holy Communion, and for the vast majority of us, that will happen within our homes. Now, if you forgot or you didn't get your bread and juice or wine, you can go sneak off and do that now. We won't be able to see you sneaking off, so it's quite okay. But I do hope that you will be ready when that part of the service arrives. I know for many of us, celebrating Holy Communion in our homes seems very, very strange, almost foreign, almost as if this was something that has come out of nowhere. Because we're used to coming together. We're used to communion being that which we celebrate when we come to worship. And we come into the sanctuary and we're here on the first Sunday of each month or on Easter, and we do this together. And it's a wonderful celebration. But there are times, like now, when we cannot be all together, where we need to be separate because we don't want to inadvertently perhaps make someone else sick, particularly those who are immune compromised. And so we have made the decision that we need to stay in our homes. But does that mean that we shouldn't celebrate communion? If we do this in our homes, will we be breaking some kind of rules or laws? Will someone come and knock at our door and say something mean to us if we happen to do this? As we listen to our third scripture passage this morning, we may hear these words differently than we ever have previously. And so I'd ask that we might listen closely. For the Word of God, as it is found in the book of the Acts of the Apostles, we're reading from the second chapter, verses 42 through 47. They devoted themselves, and they being some of the new followers of Jesus' word and way, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. May God bless this reading from the Holy Scripture. So they broke bread in their homes. These early Christian communities, when people were just beginning to hear and share Jesus' words, try to live in the way that Jesus had modeled life could be lived, they were breaking bread in their homes. So I guess it's allowed. I guess there's a question. I guess no one should yell at us if we celebrate communion in our home. Some context would help, will help. We need to remember that the first followers of Jesus primarily were Jewish people, because Jesus was Jewish, the disciples were Jewish. And so they would continue to worship together in the temple or in synagogues. But communion would be practiced in those places because that was not the practice within Judaism. So if these early followers wanted to follow the practice of communion as Jesus shared it on what we call Maundy Thursday, they wanted to follow that practice, they needed to do that in their homes. And so they did. Because it was important for the people to remember what Jesus was teaching in communion. Now this worked very, very well in another way, because within Judaism, meals are crucially important. Because during a meal, not only were people's bodies fed, but our minds and our spirits were fed as well. So around the table within Judaism of that time, teaching occurred. The elders in the household would teach the younger ones. They would teach folks the history of their faith, the history of Judaism. They would teach them the songs. They would sing. Possibly they would sing the 23rd Psalm, or most likely they would sing the 23rd Psalm. They would talk about the rules and the commandments, and while they may have committed them to memory because not much was written down, they also talked about what they meant, what these rules and laws meant, how did we interpret them, how did we apply them. There was much discussion that happened around the dinner tables, because it was understood that in order for a person to survive, in order for a person to thrive, you needed to eat, you needed to feed your body. But it was also true that you needed to feed your soul, that your spirit needed feeding. When many religious scholars and historians look back over time, they recognize, they believe that it's most likely that Judaism survived despite the many exiles that the people were put into, survived up to and into Jesus' time, because of this center around worshiping at home, around teaching at home. Because if people were exiled, if they were with their families in some place other than their homeland, they could still practice their faith, even if they were far from a synagogue or a temple. They could still practice their faith. Their faith was still alive to them. And those same scholars and historians believe and understand that Judaism has continued to survive up to and including today, despite the fact that Jewish people have been persecuted in so many places where they lived, because of this understanding that one can talk about, one can practice, one needs to do to practice one's faith in one's home. Now, in our isolation, we can feel as if we have been cut off from everything. We've been cut off from people we know and love, our friends, our families. We have been cut off from doing the things that we normally do. For many folks, we've been cut off from our ability to work and earn money. And so we can feel as isolated, as if we wonder, how can life go on? How can we continue on? And in that isolation, it's very important for us to remember that while we are unable to do or see or meet in the ways we're accustomed. We have not been cut off from God. Even though we are unable to come to St. Paul's, to our sanctuary, and worship together, we have not been cut off from God. We can continue the practice of our faith. We can continue to learn about our faith. Now, unfortunately, over time, Christianity, or at least parts of Christianity, have said that, you know, in order to practice Christianity correctly, you have to come to certain places and be taught by certain people, where you run the risk of getting it all wrong. And so we've grown to believe that. We've grown to believe that we have to come to a sanctuary, that God is only present here, and that only ministers can say the words of communion, or read scripture, or share prayers, or only choir members or choir directors can sing songs. But that's just not true. It's just not true. And as we listen to the passage that was read this morning, and as we remember Christianity began and grew and was strengthened within people's homes. And it grew and it was strengthened because there was already the tradition from within Judaism that said, around a meal, we feed our bodies and we feed our spirits. We talk to each other, we share, we learn from each other. It was true then, and it is true today. We can pray at home. We can read scripture at home. We can meditate at home. We can sing at home, and not only in the shower. And we can celebrate communion at home. Will it be the same as here? No. Am I saying that corporate worship or coming together to practice our faith is not necessarily, isn't worth it, it has no value? No, not at all. We know better than that. We know how wonderful it is to come and see each other and to greet one another and to pass the peace when we can do that. We know how wonderful it is to sit and listen to Sarah play the organ, not through a small speaker, but live here in person. We know how wonderful it is to hear the choir sing, to hear Eric sing. We know how wonderful it is to be a part of Allyssa sharing a word for the young and watch our young people as they turn their eyes and their attention to her and answer her questions. We know it's wonderful to hear people read scripture to us so we can listen and to hear a sermon. Yes, the experts, those with particular skills and talents, those who have been fortunate enough to go to school and have the time to learn more, there are things that we can share with you that are important. But it's also important for us to remember that we teach each other and we learn from each other. That we work together and serve others together. Even now, and even in the midst of this isolation, we have received food and funds that we have given to other people so that they might eat. We have other resources that we've shared with others so that they might not go without. Yes, what we do together is important, but it does not mean we cannot do this alone. We can also practice our faith in our homes, on our own, or with our families. When it comes to the practice of communion, it's important for us to remember that Jesus first shared it with his disciples. And yes, it was a part of a very special occasion, the celebration of Passover. And it's equally important to remember that the next time that Jesus shares communion, it happens at the end of the day. After a long journey, when he and the disciples sit down for a meal together. A meal that was shared with a stranger, for Jesus was a stranger to them. A meal that Jesus might not have even been invited to, other than the fact that the disciples showed hospitality and invited him to sit down. And then we are told that at the beginning of the meal, before they had eaten, Jesus took the bread and he broke it and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat." And Jesus was made known to them in that moment. An ordinary meal at the end of an ordinary day. Communion can happen at any time, in any place. And in fact, it needs to happen in many times, in many places. For in that moment, in that breaking of the bread, Jesus is made known to them, we're told. Anytime we break bread, Jesus can be made more known to us. If we stop and remember. If we remember that Jesus gave of himself so that we might know the love of God, and that we too can give of ourselves so that we might be reminded of God's love and that others might come to know God's love. We can do that around a meal if we're on our own, if we're with a loved one, if we're with our family, if we're with friends, if we're with strangers. It makes no difference. We can feed our bodies and feed our souls and spirits. And in this time of isolation, we need to remember that. We need to remember that God continues to be with us. We need to remember that God continues to call to us, saying, "This is how you can serve others, even in a more limited way." We need to remember that God continues to be compassionate with us and towards all people. And that God's love has never been isolated, but rather it is shared. For we are reminded that it can be broken and given. As we celebrate communion, we are reminded of that in concrete terms. So yes, today we will celebrate communion together. And through the magic of technology, we get to connect with other people. But technology is not necessary for us to connect with God. So let us, as we celebrate communion this day, as we break bread in the days to come, may we know that God is with us. May we know that we are all in this, and we are all in this together. And may we know that there will come a day in which we will once again be able to worship together here. But nothing is stopping us from practicing our faith in the meantime. Some of you received an email noting that we're going to change the practice of our sharing prayers just a little bit. We recognize that because this is a live broadcast and anyone can participate in it, which we are grateful for, we recognize that there are people who might not be here to worship, but might be here to find out information that could be used to harm others. And so we are only going to share the first names of people and a limited amount of what is going on with them. If you have any questions at all about who we are praying about or what more detail is happening, please feel free to call the office. Those who are on the prayer chain will continue to receive prayers as we receive them. We feel as if this is an important thing for us to do as while we are continuing to do our Facebook Live. So we'd ask that we might be together in the spirit of prayer. We ask that we continue to keep all those healthcare workers, essential workers, law enforcement people, anyone who is out there on the front lines in our prayers, that they may stay healthy, that they may receive the equipment they need so that they might stay healthy. We also ask for prayers for people who are suffering from the COVID-19 virus or for other illnesses, and all their families and friends. And we pray that all people will take personal responsibility for keeping those around them safe by following the recommendations of our health officials. We ask you for prayers for Bill and Bob, Susan's cousins. Bill is in a nursing facility and family is far away. For Steve's family, who's a cousin of Anna, we've been saying prayers for him. He died this past week. For Ethan, Anna's grandson, who is beginning chemotherapy at home. For Annette, Connie's aunt. For Mary, a co-worker of Betsy's. For Mary's families, as she died from COVID-19 this past week. And also for Cookie, who's been hospitalized, whose care is in. We offer up a celebration and continued prayers for Shannon, who is doing better. She got the results of her COVID-19 test back, and it was negative. She's grateful for all the prayers, the cards, and all the calls. She's looking forward to being able to go back to work soon. Also, celebrations and continued prayers for Sharon and Tom. Tests showed that her cancer had not spread far and that treatment will begin very soon. We want to celebrate and say thanks to everyone who donated food and funds to purchase food. Thanks to the Allisons and the Scotts and the Shainers who brought the food from here over to McVic, who then some people there divided it up in the Mechanicsburg School District, took all that food. They are continuing to distribute it at the end of each week. Right now, so many donations have been offered up that they're calling a halt to receiving donations just because they want to make sure they get out all the food that they have, that has been donated to them, as well as use the funds that have been given to them. So they will continue to distribute food throughout May and into June, and they will let us know if and when there's further need. We will continue to receive food donations and make sure that we get them over to New Hope Ministries or to the Ecumenical Food Pantry, or to individuals and people who have a particular need. Let us join our hearts and spirits now in prayer. Most gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for your presence within us and amongst us here. We pray that you will help us to understand, help us to believe that you are with us wherever we go, wherever we find ourselves, and that we can reach out to you. We can find ways to practice our faith as you have called us to. We can celebrate communion in our homes, on our own or with our families. However it is that we can, help us to understand that you are present with us in those moments. that you are reminding us of your presence within us, of your ongoing presence wherever we are, wherever we go, and that you never leave us, and that we in turn have gratitude and love for such a gift. And help and serve others. We believe you hear all the prayers we offer to you aloud and also all the prayers we offer to you in silence, and so now we turn to you in that silence. Most gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for our faith that teaches us that you hear all our prayers and you respond to them as well. Help us to receive the care, the compassion, the guidance, the peace and the love that you offer to us. And as we have received all these gifts, help us to share them with anyone and everyone we meet. We offer you this prayer and all our prayers in your most gracious and holy name, and in the name of Jesus. Amen. We are each and all invited to the mystery and power of this meal. We believe that God is present within it, within the elements of it, not only in this place, but in your places, in your homes, with you. And one and all are invited to participate and to find God's presence, as it is manifested in yourself, within you, amongst you, around you. Let's join our hearts and spirits in prayer. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is good to give God thanks and praise.
Most gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for your presence of your Spirit within us always, and we ask that that Spirit might be upon this bread, might be upon this juice, might be upon the bread and the juice and the wine, wherever people are celebrating communion on this day. We pray too that your Spirit might be upon all the gifts that we choose to share with one another in the whole of your world, might be upon each and every one of us. We are grateful for the gifts that you have given. May we partake in the mystery and the power of them. We offer you this prayer and all our prayers in your most gracious and holy name, and in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
bread. And after giving thanks for the gift of it, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
And after Jesus and his disciples had finished their meal together, Jesus took a cup. And after giving thanks for the gift of the wine, he blessed it and said, "This cup is a new covenant which is poured out in my blood. Whenever you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." These are the gifts of God. They are for the people of God. Come. This is the cup of the new covenant which has been poured out for each and every one of us. Let us all drink it.
Always remind us of
here's something, we'll call it a special bonus. When you celebrate communion at home, and you use the bread that you happen to find in your cupboard and the wine or the juice that you happen to have at home, well, each time you take some of that bread, each time you pour some of that wine or some of that juice, you are reminded that, hey, this was what I used in communion. That's part of the point. Because God is there all the time. Always has been, always will be. In the normal, regular, everyday things, God is not limited to a single place or through. God's wisdom is not through a single voice, but it is present in all places at all times. So let yourself be reminded the next time you take piece of bread. Next time you have a glass of wine or a cup of juice, may you remember communion. May you remember how we shared it together. May you remember its calls to each and every one of us and its reminder of God's love.
Let us join now in the world peace prayer. Lead us, O God, lead us from death to life, from falsehood to truth.
Lead us from despair to hope,
from fear to trust.
Lead us from hate to love, from war to peace. Let peace fill our hearts, our world, our universe. Amen.
And now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer, be with us all this day.